Sehr geehrter Oberbürgermeister Dietz, ich möchte Sie ganz herzlich begrüßen zu dieser Pressekonferenz zur Eröffnung des Vitra-Schaudepots. Da wir heute sehr viele internationale Gäste haben, werden wir die Pressekonferenz auf Englisch abhalten. Und ich hoffe, Sie haben dafür Verständnis. Dear ladies and gentlemen, dear guests from many different countries, we're really happy to welcome you all here on the press conference of the opening of the Vitra-Schaudepot. This day of the opening is a really special one for the Vitra Design Museum, also for the Vitra campus, because finally we achieved to do something that in fact we intended to do since the Vitra Design Museum was opened in 1989. You know that so far the Vitra Design Museum was one building by Frank Gehry, where we are showing our temporary exhibitions. But in fact, this building already had been intended to host our temporary exhibitions. But that was good because it helped us to establish our museum on an international level. However, we lacked a space to show our collection. So we're really happy that today we are able to open this space where we will finally be able to do that. I want to introduce with me on the podium, on my left-hand side, Jacques Herzog, founding partner of Herzog & de Meuron Architects. Very warm welcome. I would also like to welcome the other partner of Herzog & de Meuron Architects, Pierre de Meuron, here in the first row. Also welcome. And finally, on my right-hand side, I'm introducing Rolf Fehlbaum, Chairman Emeritus of Vitra and founder of the Vitra Design Museum. As I already said, this is a big change for the Vitra Design Museum because from now on we will have several exhibition spaces and we have this occasion to show our collection to the public, which had never been possible in the last 25 years. This was not ideal because over the years, since 1989, the collection had grown significantly. In the beginning, when the museum was opened, we owned around some hundred pieces of furniture. In the mid-1990s, we already had 1,800 objects. Today, the Vitra Design Museum's collection includes around 7,000 pieces of furniture, 1,300 lamps. In total, around 20,000 objects and around 100,000 archival items. So this is a significant design collection that merits to be shown to the public. And even though we were not able to show it, people knew about the collection because we are producing little miniatures that help to finance our museum. We have a poster about the collection. We did books, exhibitions from the collection. So a lot of visitors were always asking, where is the furniture collection? Where can we see that? And furthermore, with the increasing size of the collection, we also had problems of space. This is a normal situation for a museum. Every museum probably has not enough storage space, but in our case, it was really a serious issue the more the collection grew. And of course, a collection like ours also poses challenges in conservation, in climatic conditions, and so on. So finally, there was a change in the directorship of the museum in 2011, and it was one main priority of Mark Zehntner, my co-director, and myself to make the collection more accessible to the public. And at the same time, or a little earlier, Rolf Fehlbaum had come up with the idea to create a space where the collection could be stored and displayed at the same time. So this was the starting point of the idea of a Schaudepot. Our common wish was to have a building where we could display objects, but also show how we work with them, how we do research, how we restore things. We could look at certain objects, but also at the stories that these objects tell, at the narratives, at the information about certain social changes, technological changes that these objects reflect. And these were the initial ideas which then were the basis for the development of the Schaudepot concept. Now I would like to hand over to Rolf Fehlbaum to say a bit more about how the collection came about and how this resulted in the Schaudepot.
Thank you. Well, before I do that, I would like to introduce also some other people. We have here in front of us Andy Fries and Florian Stroh, who with Herzog de Meuron worked on that project. And I mean, my thanks are to all of you. It was a fabulous cooperation, collaboration, and thank you for doing a great, great job on that project. And of course, that extends also to Jacques and Pierre, who gave enormous amount of energy to that very, very small project. And I'm very, very grateful. I would also like to introduce Roland Briegel, who has been responsible for all the buildings on the site. He stands there on the right. So whenever you have questions regarding the actual building process, also talk to him. And I would like to introduce the new leader of Vitra. My tenure ended in 2013, and I'm very, very happy to introduce my niece, Nora Fehlbaum, sits somewhere in the back. Here she is, and she is the guarantor of that the cultural interest of Vitra continues. She supports all these cultural activities, and you can be sure that we will, over the next years, more to tell and more to do in this respect. Now I would like to start with the collection. Actually, I never thought that there would be a collection. Around 81, I was a bit bored with my activities, and I had the desire to learn more about our activity, which is furniture design. And I started to buy here and there a piece that I loved. It was mainly three great designers. It was Eames, or Charles and Ray Eames. It was Aalto and Prouvé. And I started to put these objects around my office. And every day I came, I was delighted to see them. And I thought, that is wonderful. But for my colleagues, it became very confusing because there was also a showroom and these things were mixed. And one day I came and a beautiful Aalto chair had broken because some big, heavy person must have sat on it. And then it was clear we have to do something about it. I thought, well, we need a space. And at that time, I got acquainted with Frank Gehry. And in a certain, we discussed about furniture and this and that. And one day I asked him, would you do a little shed for this collection? I said, well, maybe, but you know, this is complicated, a little building, I'm far away. And when we did the next factory, actually, we said, well, we set a little building in front of the factory. And that became the Vitra Design Museum. It opened in 89, and then the collection changed, because first it was a bit my personal taste. But then and there was the director at the time, Alexander von Fegesack, and he sort of had lots of ideas to develop temporary exhibitions. And so we thought about the collection to be actually the collection of the Vitra Design Museum. And from then on, we were interested in many things, not just the core, Eames, Prouvé, Aalto, but actually the whole spectrum of design from around 1800 until today. And so the collection grew and grew, but it was not visible. And of course, for our research, it was available for our exhibitions, also for Vitra, because this was always a great source of inspiration to have these products that were so innovative. It set criteria for us, set the standards. Also, we learned, for instance, when we did the Prouvé production, we couldn't have done it without the collection. So it was important internally, but for the public, it was not visible. And again, we thought about doing something about that. And then around 2011 or 12, a building just next door became really no longer useful. It was an old storage building for steel, Stahllager, and it became clear this building is no longer usable. And I thought, well, maybe we can do a basement and put a number of products into the basement and make this a shower depot. And then I approached Jacques and Pierre. Of course, I mean, if we were not friends, I couldn't have approached them with such a minor task. I just started to say, Jacques and Pierre, could we do an interesting entrance to that basement? And then it's no longer a basement. It's still a basement, but it's also a building because they first suggested to use the building, but it was not usable. And then it finally became a building. Jacques, could you talk a bit about the process of the building and what it became?
Okay, first of all, also I would like to, I'm happy you also introduced Andy and Florian. It was a much longer process and much more intense process than it may look at first sight, because it looks very modest kind of a building compared with all the rest of the campus, and especially also compared to the building we could do, our first building, Vitra House, which we finished a few years ago, which is more part, let's say, of this group of iconic buildings on the campus. And especially this one, but then also the Gehry one, and of course, even, let's say, Alvaro Cesar's and all the other buildings have a more iconic personal expression. And I find it, by the way, a very good choice to do this press conference in this space, because very few people know the space from inside, since it was conceived as a fire station, because it's the first building that Zaha could do, and this is the year of her death, which all surprised and shocked us. And I think nothing expresses your passion and obsession for art and design more than the fact that you commissioned this young architect, this crazy architect, to do her first building here. And this is a very important heritage, I think. It's still, I think, one of her best buildings. And I think it feels very good, feels right, this space, for such an activity which is so different from what it was planned for. And I think that's in itself an interesting architectural statement, that good buildings can be used for very different things. And so the first take on that existing industrial building was, of course, let's use it for your collection, for the storage. And as you said, it was not usable because it was literally structurally in bad shape, so it made no sense to keep it. But clearly the plan, especially you were like sick, we felt you, not sick, like tired of this kind of, sick would be too strong, but tired of these iconic architectures. And Pierre and I are not known for, let's say, going for the iconic for the sake of the iconic. There are some structures that we have done which have more this kind of iconic canon, whereas others do not at all. And we like to not be seen as the authors at first sight, because especially in this case of a museum or a depot, an archive, I think the object should be in the foreground. So yes, it became an architecture. It was not an underground space. It should be above ground, but at the same time, it should be more ortholess and timeless. So a normal building without being boring. And also, I think it's interesting that now on the other side of the street, not only on this side, we have a building which is still breathing a certain industrial character, but it's clearly a piece of architecture. So that gap between something visible and strong, but at the same time very held back, that's how we understood our job. So, and that was also intellectually spoken, very interesting for us, to do something which is almost like a kind of an Aldo Rossi in a more central, more physical way. So it is very physical, it is very powerful since you approach the building and almost touch the wall, but at the same time, it's just a normal building with a shed roof, which I think is a space like this one, very simple from inside, which is made to live with the change and the transformation that you want to give it inside, because we don't know how it will look like in 5 or 10 years, because the curators want to use it for different purposes.
Maybe what would be very important would be to stress your idea and Pierre's idea to link the building with the actual storage, because there was the idea for the building, And usually an architect is very happy when the client is happy and says, okay, let's go on. But they don't. I mean, they continue to, well, you know, couldn't we think of something else? And so they both came up, well, you know, something is still lacking. And Jacques at a certain moment said, why don't we do half of the building on one floor, and then we open the floor and look down and see the whole collection. That was not the most practical idea, but it opened our eyes to something very important, that what you see there, and what maybe some of you saw it already, is a selection, a small selection of a much wider collection. And Jacques and Pierre insisted on that accessibility visual, because of course you cannot walk into the general storage because for a number of reasons, but the visibility of the large collection. And I think that gave the building even another drive, because now you see the building, and then you go downstairs, you will see it, and then you see this sea of chairs and products that are all around. And I think that gave the building a really, really very interesting fact. This transparency, so that you see into what is going on, which later also from the cafe, then from the cafe you will see, you see into the offices of the Vitra Design Museum. You see even in far away the restoration place. So it becomes visible that this is not just a sort of a collector's dream, putting some beautiful object somewhere, but it's a research. It's going into the depths of this discipline. And I think that was, this gesture you made was really incredibly important.
I think that for Pierre and for me, but the same like for the Tate, it was, the job was to connect it to something existing. And the brick comes not because we like the brick or to do reference to Alvaro Siza's factory, but because the brick was the main material of, and is the main material of the existing industrial hall. So we wanted to connect it to this, and not only to the above ground, but as you said, the below ground. It is part of an organism. And otherwise it would just be a box on this plaza, this brick-clad plaza. This it is, but on top of that, it's carving out the whole existing underworld and creates a new one. And that's like a study center kind of a space, but it's also in the fact that it is attached to this and carves into the next, in the given space, it makes it spatially much more complex. So to some degree, it has a loft character and it has a cave character. And to bring this together makes the project much richer. And but this is also how we understood our architectural role in the case of the Tate, to do something which lives together with other things and looks for a balance and not for a fight against something is very important. And when I mentioned the Caesar, the Zaha building, you can see the same thing that happens underground, above ground. If you look down from the plaza over this building, that's what you said this morning, Rolf, never this building looked so good. I don't know, but it's really kind of a mise en scène. That's also the role of architecture, that you make things around better. You know, you bring things together. You make the green areas more into a landscape that connects buildings and makes existing spaces more interesting, or you discover them more freshly. You encounter them more freshly.
I mean, that was also for the whole campus. It was never the idea that this is an exhibition of architects, of architectures. It's not at all, it's a composition. And each building answers to the other building. And I think what Jacques and Pierre and you did is indirectly also homage to that building, because you never saw it that beautifully, because it was always surrounded by fences. Now, finally, you see the building. And from the terrace on the other side, you see it brilliantly. And we went there, we with a ladder, we were looking at how does it look, because it was also your concern. Let's not do something that doesn't work with Zaha's building. Let's not overpower it or do anything like that. And so I think that each architect in this whole story of the last, how many, 35 years or so, had a respect for the other, and that's why I think in the end it is a site and not a accumulation of interesting architecture, which wouldn't interest me at all. Maybe, Jacques, could you say something about the brick? Because I think this idea of using the brick in a different way was really a brilliant one.
First, I would like to finish what you just started to say. It's not a collection of buildings, but it's each building now more and more starts to be connected also by means of landscaping. I think landscaping now starts to become a major player. But what you have done, Rolf, as great as it is, I think it's unique. And also when I saw this morning the interior that the team and you have done, I don't know any other place in the world which has that, not even MoMA. So that's really great for the metropolitan area of Basel. I think this is really making this city of Basel much more interesting, not just Weil as being a part of this metropolitan area. The tram comes here, the landscape starts to connect with the buildings, and the Vitra campus has started to be what it could be. So, Nora, you have a lot to do in the coming years. It's going to be an urban neighborhood, I think. I think that's so fundamentally more interesting than an individual design object or an individual building. We are part of a city which is expanding and becomes a metropolitan city. So this is a process of metropolization, which, as you know, Pierre and I, starting with Remy, 30 years or more before, we were always obsessed by the potential of the city to take every new project as an ingredient or as a particle of something that the city could become in the future. And that things are connected, like you are connecting with Bayerler by means of this kind of art, Rewe. So I think that's much more important than what we've done with the brick. But the brick is, of course, a nice element to make this a magnetic kind of point of gravity, you know. The brick, the broken brick, makes it more central, you know, makes it more, with a very simple trick to cut the brick and to reverse it. And it makes less of a masonry, but maybe more something of a textile kind of a surface. And we've done something similar in Unterlinden and do a third version in Duisburg. But that's it, probably. But each time, it's different brick, it's a different context, and the effect is very different. But it's also, of course, goes back to other things that we've done in architecture, but always, if you break it, you know, you reveal the interior. You reveal the brick is not just an image of a brick, but it has a physical, earthy kind of a quality, which I think is very strong, especially in a time where everything is so digital or so unphysical. That effect is even more powerful, and it underscores the simplicity of the building. In a very complex building, maybe this broken brick would be over the top. But in this simple form, I think it can breathe much more of its energy, of its materiality.
Do you want to say a few words about the interior? That would maybe... Yes, obviously, the interior, that was a big challenge. How to do that interior? How much show and how much depot? How industrial or how much show like a museum? How detached from architecture, how integrated? And I think we went to a couple of steps until we reached what you see today. Maybe could you say that?
Yes, I mean, there are two things you said which were also very important for us when we started to use the building. One is this connection with the existing depots, because that also helped us from the museum side to explain what the building and the collection is about. Because, of course, it was difficult to choose 430 objects to put in the main hall. And now the fact that people can look down into the depots and see that there is much more helps us to explain that, of course, this is always a certain deliberate choice, But we thought well about it. We tried to do a good combination of the known icons and some hidden treasures, some unseen things between the experimental pieces and the popular pieces. So, of course, there was a lot of thinking behind the choice we are showing here on the ground floor. But if people prefer things they see behind the glass window in the basement, that's fine for us too, because we did not want to convey a simplistic view of design history, pretending that those more than 400 pieces are the icons and the rest is less relevant. So this helped us a lot that there is this connection, because this fits to the view of the history of furniture design that we want to give here. And also what you said about the buildings on the campus, isolated buildings on a site, the same is true for the objects in the collection. We also do not want to see them only as single items which we collect and then we put on a pedestal, but we see a lot of relations between those objects through certain attitudes towards design, through research that has been done, through influences and artistic dialogues between designers and artists. So this is the reason why we wanted to make the Schaudepot not only a display of objects, but a place where people can learn about the stories that these objects tell, that people see how we do the restoration, that we have a material library where you can see something about development processes. So all this context was very important for us, and the building helped us a lot to do that, because it exactly started with that statement that there is a space to select things, but there is also a possibility to see into the depth of design history. Maybe just some short facts. You will see much more about the building itself when we go inside. I already mentioned we show around 430 objects in the main hall. In this main hall, there's also a small temporary exhibition space where we start with a small exhibition about radical design of Italy from the 1960s. So there we will have exhibitions that are always related to the collection. That also helps us to always take different views on that collection. And in fact, also the display of the 400 objects will change over time. We do not see it as a permanent exhibition. It's a depot, and a depot has a fluctuation. It changes. We buy new things, we put them in, we give a loan, we take a certain thing out, and we want this life of a collection to be visible in that display. Then, also, we mentioned already the views into the basement collection racks. We also have a wonderful little display of the original office of Charles and Charles Eames, which came into our museum when we took over the three-dimensional estate of Charles and Ray Eames. So this is like a tiny period room that we have there, wonderfully installed. We have a material library, which is a collaboration with a Salone Satellite from Milan. We have Marva Griffin here, who collaborated with us on that beautiful material library that will help us also to convey design history to school classes, to researchers. We have a bookshop with a great selection. And so the total surface is more than 1,600 square meters, the surface that we use. So from one day to the other, we are more than doubling our museum's exhibition surface. At the Gehry building, we will also, of course, continue to have our main exhibitions. And that means that in the future, we'll have around 9 exhibitions every year at the Vitra Design Museum. We'll also have a big program of talks and debates, because this is also a way for us to discuss the pieces we are showing. And the first talk is with Martin Roth, director of the Victoria and Albert Museum in London, and Christoph Thun Hohenstein from the Museum of Applied Arts in Vienna. And we are speaking about the future of design collections, and that will be on June 13. A last very essential thing that I want to mention is a digital catalog that we are also launching today, because on the objects themselves, you will only have very short labels, because we did not want to disturb the character of a storage display, which usually doesn't have much text. So we decided to put a lot of background information, text about the objects, designers' biographies, images, into a database, which you can access when you come into the Schau Depot. You either can use your own smartphone and then you enter the Vitra hotspot, you select Vitra Schau Depot, and then you can click through that catalog. You enter the number that you see on the shelf, and then you get the information too about each object. So this is how it will look. You can try it out yourself. And actually, this can also be accessed from outside Schau Depot. So at the same time, we are issuing this on our public website, so you can access this from wherever you want in the world. It's the starting point of the online presence of our museum's collection, but it's also the catalog that you have at your disposal in the Schau Depot. You can select by designers, producers, and other possibilities. You have images of every object, more detailed information about material sizes. You have a long text, images that you can scroll through, designers' biographies. Below the biography, there's other pieces of the same designer at the Schau Depot. So we also will have benches in the Schau Depot, so you can even sit down and use the digital catalog alone. So it's wherever you, however you want to use that. So this was an important didactic element of the Schau Depot. And now I would like to open the panel because we have the possibility of asking some questions. I also wanted to mention that the architects especially will have no time to give any further interviews later on. So if there is any interest in asking a question to our guests on the panel, this is the occasion now.
Maybe you one can word still for the, on the campus. There is a new, can we see the other, yep, the other plan? I mean, the campus up till now was accessible from north, and the main buildings were in the northern part, the Gehry building, Herzog Domon's Vitra house, and the south had just this one building, but it was behind the fence, so it was not accessible. And with the new situation now, we reduce the non-public area and enlarge the public area and open the campus to the city of Weil and to Basel, because Basel is accessible with the tram very easily. And so there is now a new access that you come from Basel, you take the tram, then you go about 750 meters and enter the new, the area, the campus from here. And then you can go over the Caesar Promenade to the northern part. So that changes completely, and the whole landscape has changed. And upon the recommendation of Jacques Humbert, we worked with Vogt landscape architects from Zurich, and they did a marvelous job. And all those who have been here before will say, what happened here? Because it's a completely changed environment. And of course, this link to Basel now is it changes also the accessibility of the place. And I'm not, we don't have the time to go to the detail now, but it has completely, is a new site now, a new campus. And that was the opportunity with this building to rearrange the organization of the space.
Are there any questions? You can also ask them in German or any other language you prefer.
I have two questions. I'm from Architektur Aktuell from Austria.
Could you raise your hand so we see, yes, where you are?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I have two questions. The first question is concerning the volume, how long, how wide, and where did you derive the volume from? Has it a relevance to the older building, or where does the detached form of the roof come from? And the second question is the space before the museum. It has stages, and it is somehow put up on a platform. So why did you lift it up in that way?
Acoustically, I didn't understand the
also
first part.
Also die erste Frage war das Volumen, wo kommt das her? Also die Länge, die Breite und die Dachform. Kommt das von dem alten Gebäude oder worauf bezieht er sich? Und die zweite Frage ist der Platz, der abgetreppt ist, also und das Gebäude so ein bisschen hochhebt. Wie ist diese Idee zustande gekommen?
Also ich würde sagen, das ist einfach göttliche Inspiration und kann nicht antworten. Nein, das Volumen ist tatsächlich mehr oder weniger, was es war und entspricht ungefähr auch dem, was darin Platz haben sollte und was ungefähr das Budget war und was ungefähr auch in den Dimensionen hier passt. Wenn man sich das doppelt so groß oder höher vorstellt, dann wird es plötzlich wieder zu dominant. Das heißt, die Themen, die dazu geführt haben, sind wie häufig in der Architektur durch mehrere Faktoren bestimmt, die natürlich funktioneller Art, aber auch kontextueller Art oder finanzieller Art und auch dahingehend wichtig waren, dass wir finden, wir wollten eben, dass das sich mit diesen umgebenden Gebäuden zu einem Ganzen zusammenfügen. Und die Dachform, dass es quasi eine so archaische, einfache "This is a house" kind of a character hat, das ist ja nicht das erste Haus in unserer eigenen quasi Kollektion. Wir verwenden die Form immer wieder, weil sie halt immer noch funktioniert, schon seit Jahrhunderten oder seit Jahrtausenden und zugleich sehr prägnant und zugleich auch sehr zurückhaltend ist. Und hier hat es ja nur eine Tür darin, wo man rein und raus geht, wo diese Einfachheit unterstützt wird und dafür, wie wir vorhin ja erklärt haben, diesen Backstein, der dann plötzlich das irgendwie veredelt, aber nicht im Sinn von Nobel, sondern im Sinn von Beziehung zwischen dem Besucher oder der Benutzerin und dem Gebäude. Und der Platz davor war tatsächlich schon mal auf dem Platz des Campus. Wir wollten aber einen erhöhten Ort schaffen, weil es hat ja viel Raum ringsum. Es hat diesen Platz mit den Bäumen, der soll wieder einen anderen Charakter haben. Das heißt, es ist eine Art Gestaltung des Umraums. Diese erhöhte Plattform wird benutzt werden, das kann vielleicht Rolf auch noch erklären, für Sachen, die wir noch nicht genau wissen, aber auch nicht wissen wollen, weil es sollen dort Workshops, sollen Partys, es soll das Restaurant soll sich ausdehnen können, es sollen verschiedene Aktivitäten stattfinden und durch dieses einfache Erhöhen wird diesem Ort trotzdem etwas Besonderes gegeben, viel mehr als wenn alles einfach eingeebnet wäre. Und die Treppen, die eben nicht nur nach vorne, sondern eben auch zur Seite führen, durch diese Treppen wird eben zum Beispiel dieses Gebäude von Zaha Hadid auch wie eine Art Inszenierung. Das heißt, es hat etwas Inszenatorisches. Es ist eine ganz einfache Geste, dieses Podium, aber es verlängert das Gebäude nach draußen. Vielleicht gibt es noch andere Argumente, aber auch gut, genau, es hat Raum drunter, das hilft auch noch, wenn das zum Boden rausschaut. Es gibt, wie gesagt, in der Architektur immer mehrere Punkte, die damit, die erfüllt sein sollten, damit es nicht irgendwie beliebig daherkommt. In dem Fall ist das, also dieser Raum draußen, der war ebenso lange Thema unserer Überlegungen, unseres Prozesses zwischen Rolf und uns, wie das Gebäude selbst. Es war auch die Wahl des Materials, dass es eben nicht ein anderes Material ist, sondern dass es mit der Fabrik, die davor steht, auch wieder sich verbindet zu einem größeren Ganzen.
Das war auch immer wichtig für den Ort. Es ist ein Produktionsort, das ist nicht ein Ort, wo es museal zu sehen ist, sondern primär ist ein Produktionsort. Und was uns gerade gefällt und glaube vielen anderen auch, ist, dass eben an dem Ort, wo produziert wird, auch ausgestellt wird, dass wir das nicht irgendwo in eine Stadt oder in eine Metropole sozusagen versetzt, sondern das ist, hier kommt es zusammen, die Arbeit und das Zeigen der Arbeit, das Forschen über diese Arbeit, das Spielen auch mit den Resultaten dieser Arbeit, all das ist an einem Ort zusammengefügt. Darum wollen wir auch immer diesen industriellen Charakter auch erhalten. Und das war eigentlich eben diese interessante Challenge für dieses Produkt, dass es sich sozusagen in diese industrielle Landschaft einbringt und trotzdem etwas anderes ist als ein Industriegebäude. Und ich glaube, diese Balance ist brillant gelungen. Ich vielleicht in dem Zusammenhang auch noch, diese ganze Erweiterung des Campus hat nicht sehr viel auch mit Zusammenarbeit mit der Stadt zu tun. Und wir haben also hier das Glück in der Stadt Weil und hier jetzt repräsentiert durch den Oberbürgermeister Herrn Dietz, haben wir einen fantastischen Partner. Und wir konnten also auch in kurzer Zeit all diese komplexen verkehrstechnischen Erlaubnis für das. Und wir konnten das alles lösen, dank dieser hervorragenden Zusammenarbeit. Und das gehört eben auch dazu. So ein Ort ist nicht einfach ein Ort, wo jetzt irgendwie kulturell was geschieht, sondern dieses Zusammengehen, Stadt, Landschaft, Basel, Verkehr, all das kommt zusammen. Und das macht eigentlich, finde ich, so eine Arbeit auch so interessant, gegenüber einem einzelnen Gebäude, das noch so brillant irgendwo an einem Ort steht.
Danke. Okay, let's switch back into English. Yes, one more question we can take.
Aber es sei ja Stuttgarter Zeitung und Stuttgarter Nachrichten. Ich habe noch eine Frage, die vielleicht eher praktischen Hintergrund hat. Wäre es denn denkbar gewesen, dass man das Gebäude etwas transparenter hätte machen können? Oder ist es aus rein konservatorischen Gründen, dass es so eine geschlossene Fassade hat? Also die Frage, von außen sozusagen einen kleinen Einblick geben oder es so, wie es jetzt ist, mit der kleinen Tür und so geschlossen zu konzipieren?
Das finde ich eine gute Frage, aber sie ist, glaube ich, durch die Architektur eindeutig beantwortet. Also nein, wir wollten keine Transparenz, weil es ist ja nicht wie in einer Stadt, wo Passantenfluss ist, wo man sagt, ja, wenn die auch nicht jetzt reinkommen, kommen sie vielleicht ein anderes Mal rein, weil sie haben diesen Regenmantel gerade gesehen und der gefällt ihnen vielleicht noch rasch, dass man das rasch aufschnappen möchte. Man möchte, dass die Leute reingehen, dann entdecken sie das ein bisschen wie in einer Kirche oder sonst in einem Museum. Die sind auch nicht transparent. Transparenz wird überschätzt. Das ist wieder etwas für die Journalisten, wenn man das so sagt. Aber man muss, aber was man klar sagen muss, Transparenz ist ein Überbleibsel der Moderne, wo man dachte, durch Transparenz kann man eine politische, demokratische Kraft herbeizwingen. Es ist transparent, also ist es offen, also ist es ehrlich, also ist es für alle sichtbar. Das wollen wir, aber Transparenz ist nicht das Mittel dazu. Ich glaube, mit dieser Tür und mit diesem Ort wollen wir Neugierde schaffen. Wir wollen Neugierde und wenn du reingehst, sollen die Leute etwas kriegen, das sie überrascht und das sie packt, das sie interessiert. Wenn da Schulklassen, Studenten, Studentinnen, junge Leute, aber auch Erwachsene reingehen, sollen sie eine Welt entdecken. Und wenn man das Gleiche mit einer transparenten, mit einer gläsernen Fassade sich vorstellen würde, würde das kein bisschen besser, es würde weniger stark. Hingegen ist diese Transparenz im Sinn von Einsicht dann im Gebäude drin. Das ist das, was der Rolf Fehlbaum und der Herr Kries vorhin erwähnten, diese Verbindung nach unten. Da soll die Neugierde und durch die Sichtbarkeit, halt, da unten ist noch etwas. Da will man das entdecken. Aber das Gebäude sieht man auch so.
Vielleicht kann man noch hinzufügen, das passt natürlich nicht zu dieser wunderbaren Erklärung, aber ganz banal ist es so, dass ein Lagergebäude für ein Museum die Dinge perfekt schützen soll. Das heißt, jedes Fenster ist zu viel. Wir wollen die Dinge dort sehr gut erhalten. Das heißt, Tageslicht ist nicht hilfreich, sondern ein Problem. Und das zeigt dieses Gebäude. Es ist ein Lagergebäude für eine Museumssammlung, aber es formuliert diese Idee auf eine völlig neue Weise. Es ist eben doch kein einfaches Nutzgebäude. Aber wir hätten viel mehr Probleme gehabt, ein Gebäude, was transparent sein will, zu bespielen. Das wäre sehr, sehr schwer gewesen. Okay.
Das habe ich noch versäumt zu sagen. Das Interior, die Gestelle, die Sie sehen würden, das Storage hat daran, sind von Dieter Thiel entwickelt, der schon viele Ausstellungen für uns gemacht hat und seit vielen, vielen Jahren mit uns arbeitet. Und ich glaube, Jacques, du hast es auch so gesehen, es ist hier genau das richtige Mix zwischen etwas Industriellem, Lagermäßigem und doch auch zum Teil Ausstellungsmäßigem gelungen. Kannst du da noch zwei Worte sagen zum Abschluss?
Ja, ich finde, das wäre jetzt interessant, dann zu lesen und zu hören, wie andere das sehen. Aber für Pierre und mich war das heute Morgen wunderbar, kann ich nur sagen. Ich möchte nicht, dass dann heißt, die beweihräuchern sich selbst da zwischen dem Bauherrn und dem Kurator und dem Direktor und dem Architekten. Aber wir fanden das genau die richtige Mischung von Dichte. Es hat viel, es ist nicht eine Einzelpräsentation, es hat viele Stühle. Es ist hoch, aber es ist nicht zu hoch, weil der Raum ist noch höher. Du siehst das einzelne Objekt, du siehst aber auch die Menge. Du hast noch andere Informationen. Die Gestelle sind korrekt, aber sie sind nicht überdesignt. Also für uns stimmt das sehr gut. Und das Gebäude ist ja eine Hülle, du könntest das auch rausnehmen und wieder was anderes einmachen. Es ist nicht so, dass die Gestelle genau dem Stil des Gebäudes entsprechen müssen, aber sie tun es, sie in ihrer Einfachheit. Also ich denke, für den jetzigen Moment und für diesen Start dieser wunderbaren Sammlung ist das aus unserer Sicht des Architekten ist das eine extrem interessante Mischung. Und ich kenne keinen, wie schon gesagt, ihr seid da vertraut, ich kenne keinen Ort der Welt, wo das, diese Mischung, diese Balance zwischen Lager und musealer Präsentation so getroffen wird. Also ich kenne nichts Vergleichbares.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's switch back into English. I saw some people of the audience that...
it was not so important.
So, what I will...
I'll explain you.
One second, please. If you have additional questions, I want to introduce some people that collaborated on the project that will also be able to answer your further question, also in the language then you desire. Just very briefly, there's Andy Fries, the partner of Herzog & de Meuron, who was responsible for that project. So Andy was really a great partner also in working on that building. Andy will also be able and at your disposal to speak about the architecture. Then there is Susanne Graner. Can you raise your hand, please? Head of our collection. So if you have any question regarding the collection, she can tell you something about this. On her side is Serge Mauduit. He's kind of the brain of our collection. He knows everything about all the pieces by heart, so you can ask Serge about this. Then we have Hang Zi. She's a curator for the temporary exhibitions. Any question about the Radical Design exhibition can be answered by her. There's Jolante Kugler, who coordinated the Schaudepot project from a curatorial side. She is also very knowledgeable about all the aspects. And there's Jana Lipski, who did the digital catalog. Where is Jana? Oh, yes, Jana Lipski. So any questions regarding this item of the project, she can answer very well. So finally, it's time to go into the Schaudepot, but before we finish, I would just like to thank the architects very much for that wonderful building, which already now we know that will be great to use in our daily work. We already noticed that when we installed the pieces. It was great to install it in that space, especially because of those connections between the public and the non-public. And last not least, I want to thank very warmly Rolf Fehlbaum for having made all this possible, for having initiated the Vitra Design Museum more than 25 years ago, but also for accompanying our work in such an inspiring and helpful and energetic manner. Thank you very much.